Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Jasper Bible Church. And we are especially glad this morning to have all those that have served our country. We are so thankful for our freedom and for the men and women that have served and given their lives and service and time to our country. We are going to start this morning's service with the song Free Indeed. So if you'll stand, the words will be up and we will sing Free Indeed. Today, we are going to say the Pledge of Allegiance to our American flag. So if you'll please stay standing, let's say the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. And before you're seated, just turn around and welcome somebody here this morning.
Good morning and welcome to Jasper Bible Church. So glad that you're all here on this beautiful day. And for those who are not traveling, I know that we have many who are, but we're so glad that you're here with us and would like to ask the ushers if they would hand out the Ministry of Friendship books. And if you are visiting with us, we are so glad that you are. And if you will sign the Ministry of Friendship books along with everyone else, that will give us record of your attendance with us today. And once that book has gone all the way down one end, send it back the other direction, if you will. And that will help you to get better acquainted with those who are seated in your row. I would like to mention as well, tomorrow there is going to be a Memorial Day parade in the big metropolis of Weston. And 8:30 is when they'll be having the bike judging for the competition with that, and then the parade itself begins at 9 o'clock, beginning from the Western United Methodist Church and then going over to the cemetery there in Weston. Also, a note from the family of John King, and we had the memorial service Friday for that. It says, thank you for the nice service and the lunch after, and the ladies did a great job, and can't thank you all enough. And appreciate that from Jane, and continue to be praying, if you will, for her and for the family. Also, tonight at 6 o'clock, no evening service because of Memorial Weekend. There is a graduation open house tomorrow from 3 to 7 in the Fellowship Hall for Willie Scott. Wednesday, in the regular routine, of course, for our Wednesday services, and reminder for the teens, 6 o'clock for the supper, and Fortress then at 6:40. Anna Ruth is having an open house here on Friday. You'll notice the time, because that's a change from earlier, 4:30 to 8 p.m. For her open house. Also, this Saturday at 4:30, our church family has been invited to the wedding of Jessica Logan and Zachary Brown, and you can contact Elaine if you are interested in attending the reception. Next Sunday morning is Promotion Sunday. What that means for the adult Sunday school classes is just briefly, while the kids are being promoted, if you'll come in here to the sanctuary, when you arrive, we'll have the promotion that takes place, and then we'll be dismissed to go to our classes. So teachers, maybe 5 minutes less for your Sunday school class. Also, next Sunday morning, before our main message, we'll be having communion, so a reminder about that. 1 week from tonight will be a teen cookout at 6 o'clock. And then also, you'll notice other graduation open houses and a graduation night on June 8th, where we'll be honoring our high school graduates as well as the teens being in charge of that program. You'll notice that Saturday, June 14th, from 3 to 7, there'll be a Set Apart Girl Conference with Leslie Ludi via simulcast in our fellowship hall. And that's for ladies junior high up through young adult, emphasizing returning to Christ-centered femininity. And you'll notice that there is a supper that's provided, music from Fortress that will be provided, and you can sign up today in the foyer, and they'd be glad to answer any questions you may have about that as well. For the teens, you'll notice a next event over at the Connens, but the one where we need to be getting permission slips and money is for the Tuesday, June 24th Cedar Point trip. For you to be officially going to Cedar Point, I need to have your $35 and a completed permission slip. You can get that permission slip from me and then turn that in. Once both are in, you are officially signed up. Bible school is coming up Monday, July 7th through the 11th. Wilderness Escape is the theme. And if you would like to help out with that, you can get with Cassie Conan. I think she has some information in the foyer on that. I think there's also some information in the foyer in regard to the Light Homeschool Co-op. So a reminder about that as well. I think everything else in the bulletin is pretty much self-explanatory. But as the ushers come up for this morning's offering, to give you a few updates, Sharon Lakatos is now at the hospice home of Lenaway there on Wolf Creek, and be praying, if you will, for Sharon and for her family. Carol DeLong made it home Friday evening. Lenny Scott here with us today. I looked over there and see, and continue to be praying, if you will, for Lenny. Also Don Dunn that's in Provincial House. Bill Bockert, continue to be praying, if you will, for Bill and health needs that he has. Nina Merrillett is out of the hospital and back home. But Joyce Garwood and Tammy Long are in the hospital. And Tammy recuperating from surgery. Joyce was in there Friday and still there. So be praying, if you will, for both of them. Michelle Reed will be beginning chemo and radiations soon. That's Linda Eno's daughter. Continue to be praying, if you will, for Bev Finkhauser and health-related needs, and Ruth Rowe as she recuperates from a foot surgery, and I know that all these would appreciate your prayers. We will have prayer. I believe Molly Humphries has the special music for us, and she can be up and getting ready for that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for each one that is here in our service today, and a few minutes later, as we recognize our military, I just thank you so much for those who are willing to serve our country. And Lord, I thank you that you hear and answer our prayers, and we thank you that Lenny is with us today, that you would continue to strengthen him and encourage him and his family, and think of Sharon and Carol and Don and Bill and Nina and Joyce and Tammy. I just pray that you would meet each and every need and help them as they recuperate, pray especially this week for John Lakatos and Sharon, that you would just comfort and encourage them. We think of Michelle Reed, that the treatments would take care of the cancer that she is dealing with, for Bev Finkhauser and for Ruth Rowe, that you give them a good week of healing as well. We think of those, Lord, that maybe have a special need upon their heart, or maybe it wasn't mentioned during the Sunday school hour or just now, but you knew all about it. I just pray that you give wisdom and guidance and health and strength. Think of our country. Pray that you give wisdom and guidance to those that govern over us. You protect and encourage our military and their families as well. I ask your blessing now upon this morning's offering, thanking you for the privilege that we have to give back to you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Sent him to die.
Thank you, Molly, for the special music this morning. Steve Mean is going to come up at this time, and we are honored to have him with us, the son of David and Thelma Mean, and a missionary in Costa Rica. And he's going to briefly share with us concerning, for some of you, it's an update. For some of you, you'll be hearing it for the very first time concerning the work and ministry that goes on in Costa Rica.
My name is Steve Mean, and it's great to be here. Especially on this Memorial Day weekend, and especially considering that I was here exactly four months ago to the day, and church service happened to be canceled. And I wondered, why did Bruce cancel church, you know? And then I ended up in a snowdrift on Carlton and Treat Highway, and I figured out, yep, there's some wisdom there. So it's really nice to be here in this great weather. I wanted to introduce my mom. My mom's been here for attending this church for almost 20 years, and it's so great to be here and visit with her. I'm a missionary in Costa Rica, and some of you may think, where's Costa Rica? Sounds like Puerto Rico, could be somewhere in South America, but I thought I'd show you first where Costa Rica is. Costa Rica is right, oh, you can't see it. Costa Rica is right between Nicaragua and Panama in Central America, and it is a country that's known for its lush jungles, beautiful beaches. Costa Rica's right, that little guy right there. And it's a great tourist place to go to. But I know a Costa Rica that's very, very different. It's a place of great misery and slums and ghettos. And usually when there's generational poverty, it goes out on the most vulnerable of us, the children. And that's the ministry I'm in right now. It's a ministry called Roble Alto, which means tall oak. And it's a ministry that's been around for 80 years. And what it does is it reaches out with using Christ's love to the most poorest of the poor and the most vulnerable children. Our kids come from the slums of the urban area, exploitation, just horrible things, trading of children, poverty, and well, we won't go into the misery of it, but there's lots of things. There's great need there. And how do we care for the kids? We care for the kids. We have three daycare centers that it leaves the mom a safe place to leave their kids so she can go out and be part of the workforce while they go and learn of God's love, get three healthy meals, and go back home again to start the day again. So it's a really Christ-centered ministry and a ministry that I'm just really proud to be a member of. Roble Alto is unique in another way, too. Not only do we care for kids in poverty, we also are sustainable in a different way. And this is a way that I think resonates here in the farming community, is that we are supported in a large part by agribusiness. We own five businesses that's with the purpose of the business is to supply funds and food for the kids. And there's our product. We sell 8 million day-old baby chicks. We're a genetics provider. And what we do is we either broilers or layers, we sell them. And all the proceeds, our shareholders are kids. And that's what I do. I'm an advisor to the business side. And so you could say I'm a chicken farmer for Christ would be the way you might do that. And for the last 4 years, it's been going great. We've had increased sales, increased profits, increased donations to the kids, and it seemed like God's blessing was really, really upon us in a strong way. And then, this past year, crisis hit. We got smacked with an outbreak of salmonella, and it was a salmonella that was one of the bad kinds. I guess there's 200 and some kinds of salmonella in the world. But there's like five or six really, really bad ones. And we got one that's really hard to get rid of. And what we had to do is we had to kill some flocks. We had to shut down our incubators, which is about 500,000 birds. And then worst of all, we had to recall young hens that were already out in customers' hands and bring them back and destroy them as well. It's been a crisis. Both they shut down our borders to Nicaragua and Panama. It's been a crisis of catastrophic proportions in an economic and a financial sense. Even in a political and a biological sense, it's been just a complete failure. And it's caused us to reflect, where is God in all this? Where is our faith? Where is his role in all this? And what about his character that he would allow a kids' ministry that our sole purpose, our kids are their shareholders. Why would that happen to us? And you know, I feel comfortable sharing this with this church. Being here in the farm community, you guys know what it is to deal with the biological. You guys are farmers. You guys understand crisis. You've seen suffering. And so, what is that? How do we respond in our faith when bad stuff happens? How do you respond when bad things happened? And so for me, we're taking it one day at a time. We're buying formaldehyde by the truckload. We're cleaning our incubators. We're starting up again. And we're just taking one foot in front of the other. We are, little by little, we're starting to see gains. We have now opened our export license up to the north to Nicaragua. And it really has caused us to say, hey, is the blessing of God just because we're doing good things, or is the blessing of God because he's sovereign? And it's been a wonderful, wonderful path. One, I wouldn't probably vote if I got to vote to pick it again, but it's definitely a path that he has us on at this time. So, how can you guys pray for us? That we respond well. That our response is a response that gives faith, gives testimony to our faith. Because people are watching. People are looking for, hey, these guys call themselves Christians. How do they respond? How do they react when all these things of life happen to us? So I ask that you pray that we can continue to give testimony in good times and bad. I ask that you pray that we can continue to take care of the kids. And then, you know, when crisis hits, that's when unity and disunity kind of comes upon us. I just ask that you continue to pray for our leadership team, that we continue to be unified. Because when all the pressures of life happen, that's when divisiveness happens. And just protection for the outbreak. You know, anybody who's had a long-term sickness, you know what it is. Have to go to the doctor, he sends you to the lab, and then you got to wait for the results. Well, we've been waiting for the results every week for the last 5 months. And every week we say, oh, how did it come out? And that's our indicator whether we're doing well or not. So we pray for protection. And then finally for the families, that it's not just a physical protection, that they are protected spiritually, that they will continue to know the hope that comes from knowing the Savior. I could talk about Robelt for a really long time. I'm just grateful to be able to share it with you and share the good times as well as the bad times. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. Praise team, if you'll lead us in a hymn, which is hymn number 531. 531, America the Beautiful. 531. We'll sing all four verses of hymn number 531, America the Beautiful. Let's stand as we sing.
Grant, you want to give me a hand putting this flag up?
Maybe later. Actually, I'd love to.
And here I thought guys your age just wanted to talk about girls and face Graham on Insta-Twitter.
So close, Grandpa. So close. So, where's this flag going?
Out front, like always.
But there's already a flag out front.
This is true.
So, two flags? Grandpa, this isn't a double rainbow thing, is it? One flag is enough, don't you think?
What's a double rainbow thing?
You know, the video where he's in his backyard and he can't understand why there's two rainbows and... You just kind of have to see it.
To answer your question, I'm swapping the flags out. One out front, I fly you around. But this one, it's just for today.
How come?
Okay, this is one of those moments you wait for. It may as well be a neon sign. It says, dispense wisdom here. So what do I say to my grandson, whose generation seems more interested in selfies and sacrifice? What do I tell him about this flag? Come on. So, I fly this one every day just to remind myself.
Of what?
Of all those men and women who serve us, who protect us every day. Usually without much thanks. Without anybody even noticing how much they sacrifice. I don't want to forget that. So I fly this one to honor those men and women.
Okay, I get that. But why this flag today?
Well, I fly this particular flag to honor a buddy of mine, a guy I served with.
Do I know him?
Nah. I wish you could have.
So what makes you want to honor him?
Because he didn't come home. And it just as easily could have been me. I don't want to forget that. I don't want to forget any of the men and women who didn't get to come home. You know, sacrifice is not something you forget, Grant. So, that's why this particular flag on this particular day. You know what? You do it.
Me?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Can you hold my phone?
Sure.
On this Memorial Weekend, we honor those who gave their lives for our country. I would also like to recognize those who are with us today, who have served in our military, whether in the past or whether are currently serving in our military. And if that describes you, if you'll stand at this time, please. All of you who have served in our military in the past or present. Thank you so much. And you know, I can't help but also think about someone else who gave his life for our freedom. And you know who I'm going to talk about, that of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible says we're all sinners. We've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There's not a one of us that are perfect. We certainly couldn't enter God's holy heaven in that condition. So that's why Jesus came to this earth 2,000 years ago, to do for us what we could not do for ourselves, as the spotless Lamb of God, to die on the cross in our place for our sins, taking on himself the punishment that we deserved. As we celebrated a few weeks back, he didn't stay dead, but he came back to life again. And he offers eternal life, heaven with him, for those who will receive him and his death on the cross as payment for their sins. Please understand, there's nothing you could do to earn your way into heaven. Not baptism, not communion, not church membership, not thinking you've done more good than bad. If that were the case, then he wouldn't have had to come to this earth to die on the cross for us. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. It's not as though there are many ways to get to heaven, and Jesus is one of them. But rather, Jesus said of himself, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes into the Father except through me. The question for you is, have you received Jesus and his death on the cross as payment for your sins? If you have not, or you want to get that settled once and for all, this is your moment. If you'll bow your heads, please. God knows your heart. He knows the sincerity of your heart. He knows that there are many of you who have already made that decision to receive Jesus, but he knows there are some who have yet to do so. This is your moment. This is your time. You don't know that you'll have tomorrow or next week. You know by God's grace that you have now. If God's tugging upon your heart, this is your time to make that decision, and you can simply follow along with me in a prayer similar to one that I prayed when I received Jesus as my Savior. If you'd like to make that decision, follow along with me in this prayer. Heavenly Father, I admit that I have sinned and that I need to be saved. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and that he came back to life again. So I receive Jesus as my Savior. I invite him into my life so I can go to heaven one day. Lord, I thank you that you have provided this one way of having our sins forgiven, covered under the blood of Jesus. And for those who just prayed that prayer with me, you know the sincerity of their heart. Pray that you give them the courage to share that with me after the service today. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise team, if you'll come up again and lead us in another hymn. It's hymn number 504, Sweet By and By. We'll sing all three verses, and then we'll have our main message for today, which ironically will go right along with what Steve Mean had mentioned as far as a theme of things that we can be praying about and what they're dealing with as we look at the subject of true peace, even during difficult times. Sweet By and By, 504, all three verses. Let's stand as we sing, please.
To prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet.
If you will turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. In the New Testament, it's page 1142, if you're using the Bible right in front of you. Or in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, then 1 Corinthians, and chances are following that would be 2 Corinthians. And indeed you're right, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and in a moment we'll be looking at the first 11 verses in a message entitled True Peace. True Peace. How is it that two people can have the same trial and one person has peace while the other person is bitter? How is it that two people can have the same disease? One person has peace while the other one has bitterness. Where does true peace come from? Even in the midst of a storm, even during the fiercest trial, if you are full of anxiety today, then you're at the right place and you're in the right passage. Notice, first of all, that peace comes through salvation. What we just talked about a few moments ago. But notice verses 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God in Corinth, together with all the saints throughout Achaia, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace. Now, peace was the word that you would use if you were greeting a Jew. Shalom in the Hebrew, Eirene in the Greek. Grace is the Greek word charis, which is the word that you would use if you were greeting a non-Jew or a Gentile. So when we see grace and peace, it's like saying hi and hola. But with Paul's mentality to the Jew first, you would expect him to say peace and grace and to say it in that order. So it's intentional that he places here and elsewhere the word order of grace and peace. But the question is why? And could it be that it's because you can't experience God's peace until you first have experienced God's grace? The first step to experiencing God's peace is to experience His grace of salvation. Because you cannot possibly have the peace of God until you first have peace with God. So receiving Christ as your Savior would be the first step to having peace. But it's the first step. Because I know of those who claim to have peace with God, who claim to have received Jesus as their Savior, but they certainly are not experiencing the peace of God in their lives. So what's next? And the next thing that we see in this passage is that peace comes through comfort. Notice in verse 3 what it says. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. Oh, does that sound exciting? The God of all comfort. It must mean that God's priority is to make me comfortable, right? The God of all comfort. What a glorious verse. It must mean that when I woke up this morning, God, as a great servant of mine, said, how could I possibly make Bruce comfortable today? What could I do for him? Could I take away his sniffle? Maybe what I could do is keep his car running smooth. Perhaps what I could do is to get someone to buy him a jacuzzi. How could I make Bruce comfortable today? Now, I don't mean to unplug your spa, but the truth is that God does not exist to make us comfortable. His name is Jehovah, not Genie, right? But what happens is we often forget that, and therefore we get upset with God if there are certain things that come our path and cross our path, and as the result, we don't feel comfortable. Think about it. Some of God's greatest servants, St. Peter, St. Paul, during their time on this earth, they were not being fed grapes and fanned with palm branches, were they? In fact, for both of them, they were thrown into prison. And then they were martyred. Peter was crucified. Paul was beheaded. And Jesus' friend and relative, John the Baptist, was just ahead of him, if you know what I mean. Just trying to make some fun. But anyway, not too comfortable. And you would think that what God would say is, the way I'm going to reward my servants is to have everything wonderful always happen to them. And what an incentive it would be to therefore serve him faithfully. But it doesn't seem to work like that. And we need to remember that God's priority is to use us for his glory, not to coddle us for our comfort. So how then would it be said here by Paul that he is the God of all comfort? Why does he comfort us? And first of all, we need to realize that God comforts us not so that we can be comfortable, but so that we can be comforters. Notice in verse 4, it says, who comforts us in all our troubles so that, now we have a reason for it, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. So it brings us to another step, that one of the reasons why we do go through suffering is so that we can experience God's comfort. And therefore, we will know how to comfort others as we reflect on that which encouraged us when we were comforted by God. Notice verse 6. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. So what do we learn? We are aggravated by God so that we can be alleviated by God. Think about it. Why did God allow you to get that hangnail? Well, so that you could receive God's comfort. And then you could use that comfort in order to be a blessing to future hangnail victims, right? Because you would have experienced the hardship of a hangnail, and you would know how to deal with that. You see, the best comforter is someone who has been there and who has gone through it. Not so that you can say, I know how you feel. Don't say that. Even if you think you've gone through something very, very similar, or in your mind you even think it's identical, you don't know how they feel, but you do know how you felt when you went through something of that nature, and therefore you would know how to be a blessing to them. In verse 6, if we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. So think about this process here. Most people who receive Jesus as their Savior do so by the age of 19, it's been said. And it's also been said that 80% of adults who receive Jesus as their Savior do so during a crisis time within their lives. So God has Christians in His army who have already gone through what those who need to be saved have gone through and what they're experiencing. And what happens then is this way, those who are in this crisis can be encouraged by crisis survivors and then be led to Christ. You know, what we often say is, we say, Lord, please use me. I want to be used for your honor and glory. And usually when we say that, what we're thinking in the back of our minds is someone who is a celebrity for the cause of Christ. Or someone who is a millionaire for the master. And then we sacrificially give our 100,000 in tithe to the Lord's work. That's what we mean often when we say, Lord, please use me in my life for your honor and glory. However, what God may choose to do is to give us a flat tire so that we can witness to Mr. Goodwrench. The problem is we are so preoccupied in moaning over the flat tire that we miss the opportunity to witness. But we look at this and we realize that even when God does allow difficulty to enter into our world, He doesn't have us suffer without comfort. In fact, God's dose of comfort will exceed His dose of suffering. Notice in verse 5, for just as the sufferings of Christ flow over into our lives, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. So, for example, if on a scale of 1 to 10, you're going through a 12, God's going to give you at least 13 or more to overflow and to exceed whatever suffering you might be going through. So, do you want true peace? The question is, will you trust Him? You see, He's not going to force His peace upon anyone. If you would like to be miserable for the rest of your life, you can be miserable. You have been given that option if you want to be miserable. But if you want peace, it comes through Christ. We see another reason, another way for peace. It comes through trusting God. Now, why else would God allow us to go through problems? Not only to be able to help others out when they have their problems and when it's their turn for problems to come, but also it helps us out as well. Problems give us an opportunity to trust God. Notice verse 8. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life. Indeed, in our hearts, we felt the sentence of God. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. Many of you have heard about the tourist who was there looking over the Grand Canyon, standing on the edge, and he slipped. He plunged over, and as he was falling over, he was able to grab and hold on to a bush. He was filled with terror, and his hands were slowly slipping, and he called out to heaven, "Is anyone there?" He heard a voice say, "Yes. Yes, there is." He called out, "Can you help me?" And the voice from above said, "Yes, I can. Just let go of the bush and everything will be fine." During a tense moment, he thought about it and then he called out, "Is there anyone else up there?" And the truth is that faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. How do we really know that we can trust God? until we have an opportunity where we're put in a position where we have no choice but to trust God. You see, it's one thing to be able to sing, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." It's another thing to be able to preach that we can trust in Jesus. But it's quite another yet to have that opportunity where we had no choice but to trust in Jesus, and he has faithfully helped us through. But we also see, when it comes to trusting God, that God's past deliverance can give us confidence of his present and future deliverance. Notice what it says in verse 10. He has delivered us, past tense, from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us in our present trial. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us, past, present, and future. There was the hospital administrator who finally caught up with the patient. The patient was fleeing down the hall of the operating room. All he was wearing was that loose hospital gown flapping behind him in the breeze. The end was in sight. And as he's running down the hall, what do we see? The administrator finally catches up to him and he says, Why are you running away from surgery? Why are you running away from the operating room? And the patient said, well, it's because of what the nurse said. Well, what did she say? Well, the nurse said, be brave. You can do it. Don't be scared. Removing an appendix is a simple procedure. The hospital administrator replied, well, I would think that that would be a comfort to you. The patient said, well, the nurse wasn't reassuring me. She was reassuring the surgeon. And you know, sometimes we need to remember that God, who has helped us in the past, can help us in the present and the future as well. Here's the problem. We have a short-term memory. And it's not just for those who are now in their 50s. I'll tell you what, I can tell you this, I'm losing it. I'm losing it, and you might say, well, you lost it a long time ago, but at least I'm conscious of the fact now that I'm losing it. I will walk down the stairs to the basement and be about halfway there and cannot remember what I was going down to get. It's even worse, they've been saying, when you're halfway there and you can't remember if you were walking down or going up. But nevertheless, short-term memory. But when it comes to God's faithfulness, don't we as well have a short-term memory? God has been faithful to us time and time and time again. And then when it comes time number 589, we still doubt whether he will help us through. So we look at this and we see, where does true peace come from? From salvation, from comfort, from trusting God, but also through prayer. Notice it says in verse 11, as you help us by your prayers. This thing of prayer, keep in mind, it isn't as though God is helpless without our prayers. And there is something about the words that we say to God that magically strengthen him. Prayer is not what the energy pill was to Underdog. Prayer is not what spinach is to Popeye. At the same token, God has chosen to use our prayers as a means of delivering us from our trials. And says, you have not because you ask not. And Paul was confident that prayer was not just some psychological exercise that helps us feel better, but that is actually used by God to help the situation. We look at this, and we realize that for some reason, we have prayer as the last resort, like the spare tire in our trunk. And we think, this doesn't work, and this doesn't work, and the other thing doesn't work, and I have tried everything else. Well, I guess it's time to pray. And we have that kind of a mentality at times, rather than talking and fellowshipping and communicating with God throughout the whole process. But there's also another thing that will help lead to true peace. And that is that peace comes through thanksgiving. Notice as verse 11 continues, then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor God granted us in answer to the prayers of many. Paul had suffered a lot, flogging, imprisonment, shipwreck, robbery, false accusation. Later on in 2 Corinthians, he'll give a whole list of things that he went through. And yet, he focused on God's blessings and how thankful that he could be. As Snoopy was standing by his doghouse, he was looking in on Thanksgiving Day, and he saw all those people in there eating their Thanksgiving dinner. He mumbled to himself, everybody else is eating turkey. But here, because I'm a dog, I get dog food. Snoopy went up and laid on top of the doghouse, thought about it for a while and said, I guess it could be worse. I guess I could have been born a turkey. And you know, we have so much that we can be thankful for. But often we try to zero in on all the negativity. And today, even though it's beautiful weather outside, it's storming. But on the inside, each of us has our unique trials, challenges, problems that we face. Maybe for you it's a family storm, a job storm, a health storm, an emotional storm. The question is not, is it storming? The question is, do you have peace in the storm? As I began by saying, two people can have identical trials. One can have peace, and the other is bitter. And you'll notice that the common denominator all has to do with faith and trust in God. Is he just the one that you trust for your eternity? Well, I would certainly think that if you're trusting him with where you're going to spend forever, I bet you can trust him with what you worried about this coming Wednesday or Thursday as well. I bet the same one who is powerful enough to raise the dead could help you through what you're going to be experiencing this week. The question is this: are you full of anxiety? And if you are, you have the option. If you prefer to be miserable, that's your choice. You could go through the rest of these days of your life being completely miserable, or you could have peace. Bitter or peace. It all depends on whether you trust that God is great and God is good. It all depends on whether you are turning to him or from him during the trial that you face. Do you have true peace? The great news is you can have, as Paul tells us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for eternal life. And not only do we have eternal life in heaven, but we have you with us every step of the way. Lord, help us to realize that even though you're the God of all comfort, that doesn't mean that everything we go through is going to be comfortable, or that you exist to make us comfortable. Lord, help us to realize that you will comfort us so that we can be a blessing to others, so that we can grow in our trust in you. May we realize that true peace can be ours. Peace that passes all understanding, because we serve a great God. Lord, it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise team, if you'll come up and lead us in the closing chorus. You are my King. Amazing love. Reminds us about what Jesus did in dying on the cross for us. By the way, that's the first step. There's not a chance for having peace of God until you first have peace with God, until you are a child of God. That's the first step. As always, invitation is open. So we sing the closing chorus, "You Are My King, Amazing Love." Let's stand as we sing, please. I'm so glad each one of you could be here today. I hope you felt welcome. And a lot of things happening there in the foyer for you to sign up for. There's the Saturday, June 14th, ladies get together. It's a great opportunity. There's a sign-up sheet for that, as well as a continue on with the RAC ministry, Vacation Bible School, all the different things that you will see out there as well, the homeschool co-op information. So get a chance to look at that as well. Also, if you haven't had a chance to say hello to Steve Mean, you may have some questions for him concerning that great work and ministry there for the Lord in Costa Rica. Feel free to get with him, and he can answer any questions that you may have concerning that. If you'll remain standing for closing prayer, and Rick, if you close the service in prayer, please.
Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you love us so much that you do have mercy and grace upon us, Lord. That even with the trials and the tribulation that we may go through, Lord, you're there and you care about us and you're willing to be there to help us through that situation. I pray now, Lord, as we leave here this morning, that your blessings would be upon us. Thank you for all the men and women that died to keep us free in this country. And thank you that you love us enough that you died on the cross for each of us. And I just pray these things in Jesus' name. And I pray these things. Amen.